console controller, and I can sort of walk forward, and there's this light, and there's this door, and I get prompted with a little HUD prompt that I can just push a button. And so I do that, and I go into this interaction mode, and this little part of this circle is winking at me, and I can very quickly learn that I can click on that, and it's winking at me over here, and it's like, huh, okay. And I don't know exactly what that was about as a first-time player, but I've learned that I can play with this panel and open the door, and I see another one right in front of me. And then I see another one out this window out to the left. So there's a sort of a visual charting of what's important to the player in this carefully laid out space. As I come into this first room, you know, it's very bare right now. In the final game, it'll have a few environmental cues that give you hints about the story or what kind of world you're in the way that Myst does very well, or in the way that Half-Life 2 does. I can look around a little bit. There's this eye-catching scene out here that I don't know exactly what it is, but there's some kind of gate with an energy field blocking my way from getting through it. And then in the distance, there's some kind of peak. And again, I don't know what that's all about. But this is sort of meant to be shown to the player in a sort of subconscious way as a roadmap. You know, I'm in this spot, I'm in the beginning of the game, I don't understand much. There are some problems that I'm gonna have to work my way through, and then I'll eventually get somewhere high that's difficult to get to and that actually is very important to the end of the game. But I've gotta get out of this room to do any of that, and I see another one of these panels. It's slightly more complicated than the first one, but not by much, right? It just makes me go around a corner to be able to solve it. And then I'm out of the house, and I have a little bit of freedom. There is another one of those blue panels, and I know that I can go there, and I know generally what I can do as a player. So I've got a plan in my head, but I might decide not to do that, right? I have a bit of non-linearity already. I can go over here and kind of explore that. I can go see what's going on with this door. But this area is, I'm still in a constrained learning area. So, you know, I can't get out of here into the game as a whole until I'm shown a few of the basic concepts. So I come up here. Here's this maze. It's basically the same in form to those panels on the doors that I just saw, but it's a little more complicated. There's like branching paths and stuff. And it's got this hose coming out of it, and it goes to these other things, but they're not turned on. You know, I can't really do anything with them if I try. So I'm like, huh, but I know what I can do with this. So I come over here, and you know, it tells me to start down here again. So I'm gonna do that, and it tells me to go up there, the upper right corner. So I'm gonna do that. Okay, so I've solved it, and the hose has brightened up, and it shows me this maze, which is now powered on. So I can go do this. Right, so ostensibly, or you know, if you're gonna look at it from a purely functional standpoint, what I'm doing here is solving some mazes that aren't very difficult, but actually some subtler things are happening, right? I'm getting used to the interface of working with these panels and how to navigate that cursor around and go through. I'm getting used to the idea that there are going to be things in here that are harder to deal with than these simple lines that I drew at the beginning. And I'm being shown this mechanism that sometimes these things are turned off and there are hoses connected to them and I can power on the hose and it'll turn on whatever it's connected to, right? So I'm being tutorialized wordlessly in as simple a way as possible about how the game works. And it's important for this tutorialization to happen effectively that I'm not solving hard puzzles. But they have to be at least a little bit interesting, right? These right now are barely interesting. They just have this sort of ongoing puzzle narrative about getting more and more complicated. That wouldn't last very long, but it lasts long enough for this series of three puzzles. And now this hose goes over to here, and I've learned that hoses turn things on, and so I would think, well, maybe I want to activate these other two. And so now here we get into a little bit of what I was talking about. I mean, I almost can't verbalize what I was talking about when I say, you know, what it means to be in 3D space, but here's a little bit of the beginning of that, right? Is that I know that these cables go somewhere, and I know that I want to do something with relation to them. And now I've got a scene where I can see that they're going somewhere, and I can know that I can maybe follow them, but there's mystery, right? So there's something about things being hidden and partially visible, and me having enough of an idea about what I'm going to do, but there's still potential for a lot of surprise and mystery because I don't know what's going to happen. And, you know, there's not necessarily great surprise and mystery yet, but it's enough to sustain the narrative at the very beginning, right? And it's not difficult. Again, it's important that it's not difficult because you don't want the tutorialization to be blocked by the idea that, oh, I don't quite understand this puzzle. You don't ever get fixated on a puzzle yet. So I'm watching this cable, you know, I see that it kind of goes over here through these weeds to this lever, right? And it looks like a very programmer-already box here. You can imagine that that's a more elaborate power generator that's sitting on it or whatever. But I just learned how to interact with this lever by pushing the same mouse button I've been pushing. I can turn it on and off, and it's turning that hose on and off, right? I kind of know what hoses do, and now I know what levers do. And like I said, every lever in the game looks exactly like that and works exactly like that. So I can carry that piece of knowledge with me through the entire game. And now I've got 2 out of 3. I feel really good about this now because I'm very close to being able to do something here. Maybe I have the goal in my head of getting out this door, and maybe it's still a mystery, but 2 out of 3 feels close to being done. This cable kind of goes somewhere. I can't really get over the roof. That's a dead end back there. But I can look around the house. Oh, and I can see it coming down and through these bushes. And it goes over here, and here's this button kind of thing. And again, I go into interaction mode, and I can't really... hose isn't lighting up, so I don't know what's happening, but if I'm perceptive, and you know, sometimes people miss this at first, this is actually a substantially difficult puzzle for the beginning of this game, is noticing that there's another wire kind of going into this box. But once you notice that, it's like, oh, okay. You know, it's not that hard, but sometimes it takes people 30, 45 seconds to notice. Here's this cable, it kind of goes over to there. Well, how do I get there? You know, I'm still introducing the player to the idea of mystery and exploration, and sometimes you want to go and poke your head in corners. Here's a button, it looks different, it looks lit up. I press it, and that hose goes, so you know, those boxes would be another generator of some kind. And now this one goes. Ooh, it sounds like something major happened. And in fact, there's a light signaling that I can go through this door, right? So I'm going through this in a great deal of detail, and not because this is the interesting part of the game, because it really isn't. As a player, you would breeze through this pretty quickly, but it is representative of a certain major facet of the game in that there's a long string of nonverbal communication that is carefully orchestrated by the designer, right? Such that as a designer, I have something to say to the player. Right now, it happens to be, here's how you play the game, right? But as we get further into the game, it happens to be other things. It's how the semantic payload of the game gets delivered. We go through this door, and you can barely see it, but there's sort of little sparks that come out here once in a while, and there's some dramatic event where I kind of get shot as I go through. A very bad lo-fi sound effect. And I don't know the significance of that, but that's a mystery that will be with me through the game. I can see this wider world over here, and maybe I run out there because the game is starting to become very nonlinear now. But I have this closer objective that I can go and peek in on. There's this sort of shiny box that looks like a safe that maybe I want to get in there. Safes hold valuable things. So how do I get in this room? Maybe I come around here. Oh, I know what this is. This is one of those mazes like I've been playing with, but wow, this seems really a lot more complicated. Players generally don't really know what to do here. You might try some things. You might try like, I started tracing and those exits are flashing and I'll go to one and it's not accepting it. Huh. So this is, you know, this is the first thing I've seen where I can get it wrong. You know, the earlier mazes, there was no way to get it wrong as long as you got it to an endpoint. I don't understand this and I might play with it for a few minutes and just conclude that I don't understand it, but I know that there are other places I can go. I can see this whole area out here. So now I have a medium to long-term objective in my mind. Like, I want to get in there, I want to get that stuff, but I don't know how exactly. So I'm going to show you guys one last thing. There's a bunch of stuff I can show. At this point, there are a bunch of different areas with different themes that I can go to. Most of them are made, again, out of these programmer art slabs that are gray or white, so the world doesn't have as much character as it would have in the final game, but I can see there's kind of a castle off there, there's that high cliff with a waterfall that I saw from the beginning of the game, there's some intermediate areas down there before that. this windmill, there's these other buildings, and there's stuff over the hills that I can't even see. But there are a couple of very close areas that are suggested next destinations for the player. You can certainly walk right by them, but most people will go investigate one of these. So I'm going to go to this one. So this is another little very simple grid. And I know how to interact with it. There's no mystery about that. But these colored spots I've only ever really seen on that hard puzzle a second ago, if I even remember that I saw them there. But you know what? And I don't know what they mean, but this is a pretty simple maze, and I'll just try something. No, it didn't work. Try something else, and it didn't work. There's only four things I can try here, and two of them don't work, and two of them work. And so I find one of the ones that works, and I'm like, huh. Okay, why was that the right one? Well, I guess I'm drawing a line between these two different colored spots. Maybe I understand that intellectually, maybe I don't, right? Maybe I'm just going to go on to the next puzzle and see what happens. Still very simple, a little bit more complicated. Now there's one white spot and four black spots. You know, people might try some random things sometimes, especially if you're Stephen Totilo, but usually people very quickly try that, and it turns out to be the right answer. So now I've got an evolving concept. It's like, okay, I've got a spot. I'm separating the white spot from the black spots. So that's what I'm doing, right? So I'm going to this next one, and there's a group of white spots. That's kind of interesting. But I pretty much know the answer now. That's not hard at all. I go on to the next one, and it's like, that's just the same as what I did. But the exit that's flashing is over there on the lower left. So I got to go out that way, and I can't, right? So this is actually something that the player, a fact that has been true the whole time, but the player's never had to confront yet, which is the fact that you can't cross over your own path when you're going through one of these mazes. This is the first time it's actually important, and I might go like, how do I, you know, no matter what I do, I kind of pass in front of that, and I can't, that doesn't work. I can go around them this way, right? So, I move on. And now there's two separate groups of white spots, and I'm trying to separate them from the black ones, and I guess I go this way. Not sure what to do here. There's an empty square, but I'm just going to do that. And that works. If I'm curious, though, I can do it again, and I can try this. And that works also. So it's like, so if there's an empty area, I can associate it with either group of spots. That's cool. And here again, here's sort of a reprise of the earlier concept where there's two groups, but once again, if I do them in the same way, I've blocked off that exit. By now, it's clear to me as a player that I've blocked off that exit, so I'm going to go this way. And that's pretty quick. And then here's another maze where there's more blank spots and there's sparser groups of spots. Now again, what it seems like, if I look at this from a purely game mechanical point of view, is that I'm solving some relatively simple puzzles, one after another, about threading my way through a maze, right? But what's actually happening is that I'm building up a nonverbal narrative in the player's head, right? So from left to right, there are different concepts that get introduced. There's like, hey, there's such a thing as colored spots. And by the way, there can be multiple of each color, of both colors, actually, and you might have to go either way around them to thread your way to an exit. And they could be in, discontinuous groups. And there might be these blank spots that can associate either way. And then I'm not going to really say the last one, but it's an additional concept on the end. And each of those is like a sentence. And when you put them together in a row like this, there's a paragraph. So the goal of this kind of puzzle is to be simple enough that you keep momentum while you solve your way through these. They're never supposed to be hard enough that you're blocked on them for a long time. Well, I won't say never, because there's a lot of variability in how difficult different puzzles are in different areas of the game. But certainly for the introductory puzzles, they're all supposed to be simple. So you have momentum, you plow through it, and you build up concepts in your head. And the point of the game is not actually the puzzles at all. The puzzles are the implementation detail. The point of the game is the concepts that get built up in your head incidentally on the way to solving these puzzles. And as I look around as a player, now I have a tremendous amount of freedom. I can sort of see there's another row of these panels down there, and there's sort of on these faraway buildings, I can also see some more of these blue panels. So I kind of have ideas about what I can go and do. I might investigate this windmill, and if I did that, I would find a lever that turns the windmill on and powers something else with those hoses that I was showing you. So from here, it's basically, I understand how to play the game. I know pretty much everything I need to know. And it becomes, I'm entering into this narrative of nonverbal communication. So that's most of what I'm actually going to show. The game is actually a lot deeper than that. It has several other layers, but I don't want to spoil them this early, and they're not completely, you know, programmed in and with nice interactivity yet. But I wanted to show this segment of the game. I don't know how well this actually comes across, you know, showing it to you and explaining what all the things do to a player when you're not playing it, right? Because this game is designed to be experiential, but I find it to be very fascinating how with very minimalist elements of, hey, I've got this cable, I've got this object that powers it on and off, I've got these panels, with a very small set of elements, I can do things that are relatively sophisticated and subtle. And I think that that's all I'm going to say right now. And if we have time, I'll take questions.